in that time, in that whole time period, I began to grow more and more an appreciation and understanding of the faith and also of the Eucharist. And so it's been kind of a slow burn for me. I can't say there was a moment in time or some, you know, magical thing that happened. It was more just a slow burn. But for me, that's been the best way, because now it's very strong, very powerful in me.
Welcome to the I Am Here podcast, a space to be inspired by stories of men and women who have found in the Eucharist the strength and purpose for their lives. I'm your co-host, Leah Butalid, and I've been gathering stories for IamHere.org.
And I'm Father Mario Amori, a priest of the Archdiocese of Detroit. And today we're thrilled to welcome our guest, Deacon Mike Houghton, to share his story.
Thanks for joining us.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, we are so grateful that you would come and share a little bit about your devotion to Jesus in the Blessed Sacrament. And so we know from your title, you're a deacon. So can you tell us a little bit more about what you do, who you are beyond that title?
I've been a deacon for about 11 years now, just over 11 years. I am a deacon at St. John Vianney in Shelby Township. Been there actually for all of those 11 years. I worked for the church here in the Archdiocese of Detroit in the Curia for, I would say, about 4 years until last July. Prior to that, I was an employee of General Motors for 35 years. I started actually there as an intern when I was still in college. And as the diaconate progressed and I realized that I wanted to do something more with my life than secular work, I decided at some point to go ahead and retire from GM and come on with the church full time. So that's what I did. I worked on a project here in the Archdiocese of Detroit called Families of Parishes for 4 years. And when that was completed, I started a new ministry called UTG at Work, which I've been doing since last July.
Awesome. Can you tell us a little bit more about UTG at Work?
I would be happy. So UTG at Work is an apostolate that we started primarily because of my own experiences in the working world. I found that as I moved forward in my secular career, there was sort of more and more desire to push any thought of faith out of the workplace and to force people to not only not live their faith and not talk about their faith, but in many cases, we were being asked to embrace things that were contrary to the faith. And I didn't think that was right, but I also realized that it wasn't good to try to fight it or be divisive. And so I started a ministry with a brother deacon of mine by the name of Deacon John Manera. We called it God's Work, and we talked about how to bring the gospel into the workplace in a very positive way. That was something that meant a lot to me, and I think it was fairly successful. So when my time with Families of Parishes was coming to a close, I talked to the Archbishop and said, I have a passion for that. I'd love to continue that. There is an action step in UTG, in Unleash the Gospel, the pastoral letter, that says that he wanted to create an institute to do something like this. His action step was a little more broad, but I said I'd be happy to take that and bring it into the workplace, and I'd really be able to be passionate about that. So we've been doing that since July. And the message resonates. People in the working world all over that we talk to say, yeah, I get it. Mm-hmm. So we're having a lot of fun with this ministry.
Awesome.
Bearing a lot of fruit. Deacon, we also know that you are a husband and a father. So if you'd like to tell us a little bit more about your family as well.
Yeah, my wife Anita and I have been married for 37 years. We have three kids, two of whom are married. Their names are Matthew, Nick, and Melissa. And Matt and Melissa, the younger two, are both married. Both got married in the last 2 years, and I had the great joy of presiding at both of their weddings, which was a lot of fun. I can't say how much I look forward to baptizing their children someday, but that's not in my control as to when that occurs, so I will just wait patiently.
And what is your day-to-day ministry or week-to-week ministry as a deacon at St. John Vianney look like? What sort of things are you involved in?
You know, we are so blessed at St. John Vianney. We're a very, very active parish. Our pastor, Father Jim Grau, has been there almost 2 years now, and he's just a big believer in starting ministries and evangelizing. So I have the great pleasure of running a men's group. I do most of the baptisms at St. John Vianney, and we probably baptize about 20 kids a month. Yeah. So we do them in large groups, and that's a lot of fun. My wife and I have done the RCIA program for 8 years now. Obviously, just concluded with the Easter Vigil here. Now we move into Mystagogy, and that's actually a little bit of what I wanted to talk about as well for the Eucharist, because that RCIA ministry is a chance when people get to see the Lord in the Eucharist, in many cases for the first time, or at least to understand what they're seeing for the first time, and what a joy that really is.
Beautiful. Well, we're excited to kind of get into what you have shared with us on IamHere.org, but I want to kind of get a little bit of background context. Can you talk a little bit about your introduction to the faith and how you first kind of came to encounter Jesus in the Eucharist, some of those early encounters?
Probably the best description for me is slow burn. I'm a cradle Catholic. My family was very Catholic. My parents took us to Mass and brought us to religious ed. And I don't think I understood it when I was in middle school. Our catechism wasn't very good. And in high school, I started feeling a call. I just felt there's something more here. I don't know what it is. My mom, to her credit, said, well, let's go talk to our pastor. Maybe it's a calling to the priesthood. So when I talked to the pastor, and we talked it through and concluded that I no offense, Father, I really didn't want to be a priest. there were other goals that I had that I felt called to, but I still wanted to be in ministry. And so he said, have you heard of the diaconate? And this was a while ago, and I hadn't heard of it. So he said, go down to Sacred Heart Seminary and talk to them about the diaconate. And I did. So at 18, 19 years old, maybe even 17, my mom took me down to the seminary. I met and heard about the diaconate. And right then and there, I said, that's what I want to do. There is no question in my mind, that's what God's calling me to do. And God was calling me to do that for a long time. And then life happened, and I got married and had 3 kids and a job, and everything got crazy. But I still kept hearing God say, you need to do this. You need to do this. And so finally, at one point, I just said, I don't know how it's going to happen, God, but if you want me to do it, I'll try. And so I applied to, was accepted into the diaconate formation program. Probably one of the best decisions I ever made, short of marrying my wife and having my children. It's been a tremendous blessing. In that time, in that whole time period, I began to grow more and more in appreciation and understanding of the faith, mm-hmm. and also of the Eucharist. And so it's been kind of a slow burn for me. I can't say there was a moment in time or some, you know, magical thing that happened. It was more just a slow burn. But for me, that's been the best way, because now it's very strong, very powerful in me.
Mm-hmm. What would you say, what were some, I guess, defining moments for you, or, you know, as that slow burn happened between 17 and, you know, the time that you discerned and fully entered into the diaconate program, what sort of things in your faith life just inspired you to keep going and to keep seeking?
A couple things that happened for me were having parents of very strong faith. That was quite helpful to me. I lost a brother at age 40. When he was 40, I was 37 at the time. We had no idea that he had any health issues, and it really caused our whole family to stop and say, wow, life could end at any time. Those moments kind of force you to hit the pause button in life and say, wait a minute, there's something more here that I have to be aware of. Maybe I've been pushing it aside, but it's real. So those were kind of the key things for me to really just keep growing and growing and growing and saying, there's something more here. But I say this a lot, and it sounds almost silly, but really for years I felt the Lord tapping on my heart saying, you need to do more. I'm calling you to do more. And I kept saying, oh, no, I'm not ready yet. Just give me time. I'll get there. And I had to finally say, I'll do it. And that came through some discussions with some priests that I knew and trusted and said, I'm feeling the calling, but it isn't the right time. And they all said to me in the same way, if that's what God wants, go do it. He'll clear the path. And he did. And it's been wonderful.
So often in discernment stories, we hear of just the centrality of the Holy Eucharist and time before the Blessed Sacrament. Was that a part of your kind of discernment, and how was that an aid to you?
It was. I pretty much discovered Eucharistic adoration after college. Not that I hadn't been through it before. Don't misunderstand me. I had. Mm-hmm. But I began to really appreciate it more after college, especially when my kids came along. And I realized that I could have that sort of that quiet time with the Lord and really feel his presence. And I would say that early on, I didn't understand what I was feeling. I didn't quite get it. I knew there was something special there, and I wanted to go back, but I didn't quite understand what it was. And so it took me a while to realize, yeah, you know what? All the stuff I heard about through my church, through my reading, through my, eventually my seminary courses, is just so very real. It's right there in front of me, and I didn't really appreciate it for so long. And now I see it in other people who don't really appreciate it. They stand before the Eucharist and don't understand that this is Jesus Christ, body, blood, soul, and divinity. And if I would have had that appreciation younger in life, I probably would have done things a little bit differently in my 20s and 30s. But, you know, it's exciting to come to that revelation and realize that there in that presence, there's this connection that I talk about in my article, the connection between heaven and earth. And it's very, very real.
I'm so inspired by the way that you kind of look back on this extended period of time and can recognize the ways that the Lord was working. And there's one thing that you shared in your in the story that we've published on I Am Here about the power of Jesus' words at the Last Supper and how those have struck you and how over time, you know, the Lord brought you into this deeper understanding of what they mean and what they mean for you. And I would love for you to kind of share with us how the Lord kind of brought you into that understanding. What did he begin to reveal? What was that process like over time as you have reflected on those words over and over and over again?
So at the Last Supper, Jesus told his friends, his apostles, you know, I will not leave you orphaned. And I reflected on that a lot over the years to say, well, what does that mean? And certainly I've always understood that to mean the Holy Spirit, the Paraclete, and I've always appreciated that. But again, it was later in my 20s and 30s when I began to realize that he also meant that in a very powerful way in the Eucharist. He's there with us physically in the Eucharist when we get to spend time with him. Mm-hmm. And as I began to get more and more into an understanding of the Eucharist, into appreciation for Eucharistic adoration, I began to realize that that's a big part he was saying, of what he was saying as well. I won't leave you orphaned. When I walk into the church at 6:30 in the morning on Sunday and I open it up for 7:30 Mass, I'm not alone. Mm-hmm. He's there. And I have a friend there, and it's a very real thing for me now to know that Jesus Christ is present in that Eucharist. He didn't leave us orphaned. He's right there. It's a mysterious way, and I understand that, but he's there, and I feel it, and I believe it.
The scriptures always speak to us, you know, in our present day realities. They're not, I mean, they are words that have been inspired and written many, many years ago. But, you know, we say that the scriptures always have words to speak to us today. And that's, I think that's why Eucharistic adoration, I mean, that is why Eucharistic adoration and the reading of the scriptures go hand in hand. We have to have that context of like what Jesus says and then how that is made a reality for us today. And I think what you shared with us is just another reminder of that the Lord always makes promises that he intends to keep. He always makes promises that he does keep. And so knowing the scriptures, we know it is knowing Jesus, and knowing the scriptures is knowing this friend, you know, this our brother, our Savior, more intimately. And so so many have shared with us over the course of the many episodes that we've done just their own prayerful practices during Eucharistic adoration, and I think this highlights just another one of those.
Yeah, I particularly like to pray a rosary during Eucharistic adoration, but I also make it a point to stop and just listen. I always have to stop myself and say, this isn't just me talking, this is me listening too. Mm-hmm. And that's hard for me. It's hard for everyone, I know that, but it's hard for me to just stop and put everything on pause and say, I'm just going to listen. But when I do, so many good things come from it. It's incredible.
Can you share what some of those good things are? Can you look back on any particular memories or maybe just over time? What has the fruit of that stopping and listening been for you?
One of them is what I'm doing right now in my ministry. Because as my time was wrapping up in families of parishes, I had a lot of options. I could do a lot of things. I could have gone back to the secular world. Frankly, could have made a whole lot more money, but that's another story. I could have continued on in maybe an administrative role here in the Curia, and I was offered an administrative position in the Curia. But the more I prayed about it, I said, I need some direction. Help me out here. Mm-hmm. And what the Lord put on my heart through adoration and through time in my own little prayer in the evening is, you need to follow your heart, follow the ministry, go do that. And so I approached the Archbishop and talked to him about that, honestly thinking he would say no, to be candid. I thought he would say, no, we're not going to do that. But to his credit and to my benefit, he said, yeah, let's give that a try.
Beautiful, beautiful. So you've shared a little bit about how you've come to sense this connection between heaven and earth that you've experienced and come to know quite profoundly through the Eucharist. Can you kind of unpack that a little bit for us? How did you come to recognize that connection, and what does that mean for you? How does that impact the way that you spend your time before the Lord and spend your time, you know, serving him in the world?
There's there's a mystery there, of course, in this connection between heaven and earth. I believe it to be real, and I believe that the Eucharist is sort of a conduit or a pathway that shows us that connection between heaven and earth, because you've got these earthly elements of bread and wine that through the consecration now become the real presence, and we see the heavenly Jesus Christ, the risen Jesus Christ there. And I know that in that moment of the Mass when Father elevates the bread and wine and through him, with him, and in him, it's that time when heaven and earth meet, that connection is made. And so when I look at the Eucharist, I say, somehow, in some way that I don't fully understand, but I do appreciate and believe, that's the connection. That's the link between what we do on this earth and what we will have someday with the beatific vision. And I believe that very strongly. It was made very real to me, a little over a year ago. We had a funeral. It was actually a funeral of a friend of mine at the parish who I had known for many years. And I was behind the altar after the consecration looking forward, and I could see the bread and wine in the casket. And this tremendous irony hit me that here's the bread and wine that was dead and is now alive through the consecration, and here's this body that was once alive and is now dead. And somehow that connection is there. That connection was made that he's now with the Lord, who I'm looking at here on the altar. And it was just this mysterious moment for me to really ponder and contemplate.
Mm-hmm. That's powerful.
In what other ways, as a deacon and in your in the awesome opportunity that you have to serve at Mass, how does that impact your just love and devotion for the Holy Eucharist?
I am truly honored to be there so close when the priest consecrates. To me, that's a very special thing that not everyone gets to do. And for those deacons who are able, like myself, in that epiclesis, I'm on my knees. And there's a couple of reasons why I'm on my knees. One of them is because I need to disappear at that moment. The deacon is completely irrelevant. It is the priest in persona Christi and the Eucharist. That's what matters. But the other reason is out of reverence. This is my Lord and my God. It's Thomas in the Divine Mercy Sunday Gospel reading coming up this week. My Lord and my God, you're there. And I take that very seriously. There's going to be a day when I can no longer kneel. Maybe I'll just bow. But I still will always do it in reverence. And even when I'm not serving at Mass, as the priest bows, I bow my head in the pews, because that is the real presence of Jesus Christ, and that deserves reverence and respect, and I will always feel that way.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it's similar as a priest, you know, having knowing the ins and outs of who I am and my own frailty and sinfulness, and then also having this awesome opportunity to we say confect the Eucharist by our prayers and through the working of the Holy Spirit. For me, it's always this great sense of really wonder and awe and as you said, just reverence for what the Lord is able to do through us, what the Lord does, you know, through the ministry of the priest. And I think even more that helps in my own love and devotion for the Holy Eucharist, that, you know, the God of the universe makes himself known to us through us. And just an awesome opportunity that is, and a great just a great gift of his love and mercy for us.
No question about that. And to be that close as it's happening is a gift to me. Mm-hmm. I'll never be able to do what you do, and I'm okay with that. I'm glad there are enough of you to keep doing it, but it's an honor to be there.
Deacon, in this season of Eucharistic revival, I know that there are things happening all over the country, things happening here locally, and in an effort to, you know, revive our devotion to Jesus in the Eucharist. I'm curious, how might you encourage listeners to seek that revival first in their own hearts? You know, before we start talking about the events and the things that people can go to and sign up for, how do we seek revival in our hearts when it comes to our devotion to Jesus in the Eucharist?
I can tell you what's worked for me in a very profound way, and that is that I mentioned earlier, my wife and I run the RCIA program, OCIA. We've done it for 8 years now. And we have the opportunity to bring people in who maybe don't know a lot about the church, about the Lord, about the Eucharist, and to spend some time with them talking about the scriptures, and then bring them in for adoration, and to see the looks on their faces, to see people who maybe don't really even fully understand what's happening yet, break down in tears. It's just an amazing experience. And you bring them back and you say, what happened? I just felt something. Right, I get it. When you see it in others, it strengthens it in you. Mm-hmm. These people who don't, the wonderful people doing, really learning about the church, I admire them, but they don't have the knowledge yet. They're kind of fresh, they're newbies, mm-hmm. but they get it. They get it. They sit before the Eucharist and feel the power and they cry and you say, wow, that strengthens my faith in a very special way. It's Jesus working on them that ways I never could, trying to teach them a class mm-hmm. or, you know, talk to them about the catechism of the Catholic Church. This is the real presence and it's powerful for me to do that. So maybe bring someone else to adoration, you know, mm-hmm. maybe someone who's not quite as devoted as you may be and experience their reaction and see how they react. Talk to them afterwards. What did you feel? Mm-hmm. It just kind of builds up in me the belief that I have and makes it even stronger.
Mm-hmm. Deacon, we've spoken about your ministry as a deacon, your work in the new apostolate that you have, your work in the parish and in OCIA, but also am curious about just your own ministry in your family mm. to your wife and to your children. Again, over the course of the many episodes that we've done, we've heard over and over again just the power of a father, especially. That has been something that has stuck out to me over and over again, of kind of a father's faith or a father's encouragement or prayers for their children. What advice or what encouragement would you give to parents out there, or how have you seen maybe the fruit of your own labors in your family?
Well, whether it's something my wife and I did or just the grace of God, we're blessed with three wonderful children, all of whom are believers, all of whom really understand what it means to be a person of faith. And the beauty that we had as a family was that as I was going through the diaconate training, they were in middle school, and we had the chance to talk about what was going on and share things. And so I think one of the most powerful things that any parent can do is to get on their knees at church or in front of the Blessed Sacrament with their children. You don't have to say anything. Just show them by your example that this is something that I reverence. Because kids, by their nature, have a certain respect and appreciation for their parents. And when they see something means a lot to their parents, it means a lot to them. And so I found that experience with my own children. They know this is important to me. They knew when I was younger that it was important to me. And now as they're getting older and they're getting married, it's important to them as well. Mm-hmm. And frankly, my wife and I are very pleased that they are people of faith. We've seen so many families where children fall away. And, you know, it's not any way to be critical of anyone. It's a difficult world. I understand that. But we look at our three and we say, thank you, Lord. You know, we're feeling good about that.
Mm-hmm. Thank you so much, Deacon, for sharing just the many ways that you have encountered Jesus in the Eucharist, how that's impacted you and the way that you have shared that gift with others. You mentioned, you know, the ways that you're inspired by those who go to the Eucharist and the reactions that they have. I feel like that's my experience. Every time we have someone on this podcast, it strengthens my faith in the Eucharist and you know, hope and pray that it strengthens the faith of our listeners. So thank you once again for sharing, you know, the goodness that God has given you through His real presence.
My pleasure.
Thank you for listening to the I Am Here podcast. You can read and listen to more stories of people encountering Jesus in the Eucharist at iamhere.org. And we also invite you to share your story with us. I Am Here is a campaign by the Archdiocese of Detroit and Hello App in support of the National Eucharistic Revival.